Hey, Trevor Packer with the College Board, you're on. Appreciate your time. We're running about an hour, 15 minutes behind right now, so that's okay. We're here to midnight. We need to be.
Well, let me start by giving my respect to Ms. Diddy and the organization she represents. And it's been painful for me to sit here for the past hour and hear these statements about the APUS history program, because I'd like you to look at the evidence for yourselves. Not a single slide that you were just shown represents the facts with accuracy. And I know that's not because Ms. Diddy was attempting in any way to mislead this committee. I have respect for her committee's work. But if I had received the information she had received and that she shared with you, I would be tremendously dismayed and frankly outraged by the APUS history program. The notion of cutting or reducing an emphasis on the founding fathers, on the heroes of American history, on American exceptionalism, on battles, the notion of not revealing the names of people who wrote the framework, the notion of trying to co-opt state standards would outrage me. And none of those things are true, but I'd like you to make up your minds for yourselves by looking at the materials. To give you a little bit of my background, I come from a very conservative state and I'm deeply concerned in my own personal life about the erosion of family values in our country. I teach an Old Testament Sunday school class each Sunday afternoon, and I'm very committed to the notion of America being an exceptional nation. To answer your question very directly, Mark, the apples-to-apples comparison of the old five-page outline that Ms. Diddy showed to you with the new framework, which admittedly looks a lot slimmer when it's not a photocopy, so this is what the bound copy looks like. The apples-to-apples comparison of what's required to be an APUS history program when a teacher applies to the College Board to receive authorization to label their course AP is 5 pages in the old book versus 7 pages in the new. So Dr. Scott, it was a very astute observation of yours to make that this 140-page document is full of practice test questions and descriptions of skills and a glossary. When a school applies to become an APUS history program, there are 7 pages of requirements, whereas before there were 5. So I thought it would be helpful to give you a sense as to why I initiated a redesign of the APUS history program in 2003. I became the head of the AP program in that year, and the first move that I thought I should make would be to survey AP teachers across the country and determine how they felt themselves about the AP program. I have tremendous admiration for the work of teachers, and I really wanted to understand, were they feeling good about the pressure that the AP exam placed upon them to teach certain things? So we surveyed teachers across disciplines, and we found out that while math teachers and English teachers tended to love the AP program, science teachers, history teachers, and world language teachers were very upset with the current state of AP. In fact, 72% of APUS history teachers reported that the old 5-page outline put pressure on them to buy 429-page outlines from test prep authors, because the old 5-page outline simply didn't tell them what would be on the exam. So they felt pressure to cover everything possible, and they reported that it made it very difficult for them to satisfy state and local requirements. As someone who comes from a state that deeply values, I come from Utah, and a state that deeply values sort of local control, it was important to me that AP not be competing with states for the content that states prioritize. I did not feel that Georgia or Maine or Utah should all be forced to teach the same content by what showed up on an AP exam. So based on that feedback from APUS history teachers, I implemented a redesign process. You've heard that we kept the names of the faculty who wrote the new framework mysterious. I don't know why people claim that. They're on page 5 and have always been on page 5 of the document. There's no mystery. The names of all of the faculty who've been involved are here. So could I take a few minutes and give you some information for you to look at that compares the old AP program to the new AP program, so that you can make up your own minds about whether or not the new program better serves the students in your state. So if you've each got a dark blue folder, says somewhat obnoxiously College Board right on the front of it. If you'd open up the folder and pull out to the left, you'll see a set of slides. And on the right-hand side, we've got an old exam and a new exam so that you can tell me which you think better honors your state standards and better supports a balance of political perspectives rather than simply liberal and liberal perspectives. So let's start looking at pages 2 and 3 if you just flip open the slides. It is not accurate that AP US History is the first AP exam to have been changed. We change AP exams from year to year and have been doing so over the past 60 years. This is not even the most recent redesign. This is not the only redesign of this decade. Throughout this decade, the AP Biology redesign took place 2 years ago. AP Chemistry and AP Spanish took place last year. AP Physics has also been redesigned this year. Next year, AP Art History. The AP program must continually update its materials to align with what your colleges are teaching so that we can ensure that your students receive college credit. So if you look at page 3 describes the current state of AP in Georgia. And this past year, Georgia students qualified for about $61 million in college credit through their AP scores. The majority of college admissions officers are saying that seeing that AP course on the student's transcript will favorably impact the college admissions decision. And we're really pleased with this because it enables your students not just to qualify for admission and credit within the state. And 73% of the AP students in Georgia do apply to your own state's colleges and universities, but 27% are able to use that credential to receive credit and admission to universities outside of Georgia. So a challenge, we also at the College Board like dual enrollment programs, but sometimes they're not recognized outside of your own state. So this helps your students stand out to other states as well. And an interesting fact, of all the colleges and universities in the world, the University of Georgia at Athens ranks 7th in the world in the number of AP students who attend, and Georgia Tech ranks 18th. So looking at page 4, here is how we develop AP exams. Not a single AP exam question is written by myself or my staff. The College Board staff, it is not our responsibility to write the AP exam questions. So occasionally that frustrates me. It happens, the fact of the matter happens to be that in AP Art History, my very favorite painting in the world is not included in that course or exam. My very favorite statue in the world is not included in that course and exam because it's not my role, it's not the College Board's job to say, here is what must be taught. No matter how much I might love that painting, the fact that it's my favorite painting doesn't matter because it's not the College Board's role to dictate content to states or schools. That is the role of the university system and the secondary school system working together. So you can see on page 4, more than 200 Georgia professors this year worked together to write the AP exam questions with professors from other states and to score the AP exams. And then if you look at page 5, you can see in micro print that more than 400 Georgia teachers also worked to write the AP exam questions and score the AP exams. So I wanted to make sure that was clear. It's teachers and faculty from across the country that work together. So why did we decide to redesign AP US History? Well, we found two problems. Once I surveyed those AP teachers and they said, and 72% said, we do not like AP US History, I wanted to understand why. Why would the majority of AP teachers say, we don't like this course? That felt important to me. So you can see on page 6, the first thing they really disliked about the course. The first problem is only one question on the entire test actually asked the student to look at a historical document. Instead, the test was full of multiple choice questions that could be written about anything a college professor wanted to write about. So because the old framework was only 5 pages long, college professors could write about anything. So you'll see some of the things that showed up on the old AP exam. Every AP student in the world had to respond to those questions. So while the 5-page topic outline did not mention Marcus Garvey or the 1979 incident at Three Mile Island and emphasize that negative event in American history, it could show up on an AP test because that 5-page outline didn't restrict anything. Anything goes. And if we're concerned about the liberalization of American education, we should be concerned about an old AP model that allowed any exam question about any topic under the sun that a professor cared about to make its way onto an AP exam. These questions are no longer allowed, because on the new AP exam, if you look at the next page, the new AP exam, every AP exam question now must be based in a document from American history. So what this says is, it's not a college professor's opinion about American history that counts. Students are not going to be scored on whether they agree with the opinions of college professors who submitted multiple choice questions to show up on the AP exam, because all 80 of those multiple choice questions have been removed from the exam and replaced with 55 multiple choice questions that require students to look at what the founders of our country actually said and other great leaders in American history. So every question now, and I've got for your own review, if you'll take out of the right side of your packet, the old exam versus the new exam. You can see the second problem with the old exam right on the cover. It says the 2006 AP United States History exam. That's the last time an AP exam has been shared with the public, because for the old AP exam, they were only released once every 5 to 8 years. The public has not seen an AP exam since 2006. One of the commitments we've made with the new AP US History exam, and one of the things that made me most excited about redesigning this program, was we put in place a test development process that allows us to release the AP exam every single summer. I believe we should be held accountable to the public for what's on an AP exam. I believe people should care. That's why I'm grateful for organizations like Ms. Diddy's that raise these questions. How sad if we lived in a country where no one cared about what would show up on an AP exam. So it is inspiring, this dialogue, but I do want you to look at the exam side by side, and you tell me which does greater honor to your local standards and local control. So if you look at the old AP exam, flip, for example, to question 5. There's the Kent State University. Do you agree that every student in Georgia should have to study the Kent State University riots? Do you believe that? Well, that's what the old AP exam required, because anything could show up on it, because that 5-page framework did not give any specificity. Look at question 7. Do you believe that every student in Georgia should be tested on the Congress of Industrial Organizations? Look at question 8. Do you believe that every student in Georgia should be tested on union membership cards? Look at question 28. Do you believe that every student in Georgia should be tested on the founding date of the National Organization for Women, an organization that has made its name as a sort of pro-abortion group? Do you believe that? Look at question 37. There's the question on the Three Mile Island incident. Is the Three Mile Island incident in Georgia's state standards? So that's a concern I had as I looked at the old exam. None of these require students to actually look at primary source documents. They rely on students agreeing with the opinion of that professor who wrote that question. So we've replaced the old exam with the new exam that now requires all of the questions to be based in the actual documents of American history rather than one professor's perspective. So that's change number 1. Let's look at change number 2 that we've made. Flip to page 8 of the slides. Here is what the old 5-page outline looked like that Ms. Diddy mentioned to you. As you can see, to Mr. Glanton, did I pronounce your name correctly? To Mr. Glanton's point, look at the bottom of page 8. There was no reference to Martin Luther King Jr. There was no mention to Rosa Parks in the old framework. In fact, there wasn't a mention of a single woman or minority in the entire old 5-page outline. Not a single reference. That's a concern of ours. The new framework is full of references to the diversity of American peoples, and I would not position this, as Ms. Diddy did, as a record of strife, but as a record of peoples working together to accomplish equality and liberty, which are the ideals on which America was founded. So I don't see the new framework as negative, but I would be curious for your feedback if you do. We have a public review process that opened on October 1st that runs through February 28th. And we'd welcome any feedback if you see examples of the way the framework is negative, because the intent is not that the framework be negative at all. Looking at the old framework on page 8, you can see the old framework didn't list names. All of the people that Ms. Diddy said were cut from the framework have not been cut, because the old 5-page outline never listed those people. No one's been cut because no one was listed. In fact, the only names you can see are presidents, because the only names in the old framework were the names of 9 presidents. That's fine, because the purpose of the framework is not to co-opt your state's control. By design, neither the old framework nor the new framework list names, because it's the role of the teachers to select the content for the course. So let me show you how that works. On page 9 of the slides, we wanted to solve this problem. The old framework, actually let's go back and look at page 8 just to show you how problematic this old framework was. Look at the very top on the old framework. Every teacher was required to teach development of the West in the late 19th century, including gender, race, and ethnicity in the far West. What is that? If you're a teacher, you're thinking, am I supposed to teach a unit on Annie Oakley? Am I supposed to teach a unit on Calamity Jane? What is gender in the far West? What are the environmental impacts of Western settlement? I'm not convinced that students in Georgia should be required to do a unit on environmental impacts of Western settlement. These things were so vague that they put pressure on teachers to buy test prep material, 429-page documents like this one, that filled them with stuff to try to race through on that exam. So the new AP says, okay, we are going to no longer allow college professors to submit test questions about anything under the sun. We are going to survey colleges nationwide and say, you must prove to us the concepts that are truly required at your university to grant college credit. We developed a long list for the colleges to review, and unless they were willing to score, unless each topic received an average score of 7 out of 10 points in terms of being critical for college credit, we said, we're not going to mention it in our framework because we don't want to put pressure on schools to cover everything that any individual college professor feels is important. So the new framework consists of, looking at page 10, a list on the left-hand side of what the colleges reported they felt was essential for college credit. In the middle of the framework, there is space for teachers to then decide what content they are going to choose to investigate that claim. On the right-hand side of the framework, we describe what the AP exam questions will be about. So if you look at this example, the first example is the colleges indicated that for college credit, students needed to know that the United States and its allies achieved victory over the Axis powers through a combination of factors. The teacher can then say, how do I want to teach the Allies' victory? One teacher might choose to focus on D-Day and the invasion of Normandy. Another teacher might choose to focus on the battles in the Pacific. The College Board should not be mandating that all teachers teach the same battles. It's up to the schools to make that decision. But students will be required to furnish an example of such victories on the exam, but they now get points for the battle they chose to focus on in their state, in their school, rather than having to know whatever was on a multiple choice question. So the way the new AP US History exam works is the teacher gets to choose which content to teach, and then the exam questions give students points for the example they choose to use. The students do need to know an example of how the United States achieved victory. That's the concept required for college credit. You can see on the left-hand side, concepts required for college credit that the Allies played a leading role in the victory of World War II. This was very important to me. The old AP US History framework didn't mention a single battle except Pearl Harbor, which was a defeat. That's painful for me as someone who, both of my uncles fought in Vietnam. My grandfather was a World War II veteran. I take tremendous pride in America's military past. The old framework only mentioned Pearl Harbor, didn't mention Gettysburg, which the new framework mentions, didn't mention the battles in the 18th century, which the new framework mentions, didn't mention the battles of World War II. But the new framework does require that teachers pick an example of each of those. We don't mention those by name because we don't want to say every student in every state must learn the exact same battle. Instead, the teacher gets to pick the battle, and our test questions ask students to describe the evidence of American military victories that their teacher taught. So that's how we've addressed that issue. We need to report to the public what colleges require for college credit. We can't censor that. It would be entirely inappropriate for us to not share with the public what colleges require for college credit. But we do need to manage that more effectively than we did in the past, by ensuring that the AP test questions themselves give students flexibility to use whatever battle or whatever individual their teacher chose to teach. On page 11, you can see how teachers have reacted to this. For the old AP US History course, 72% of teachers felt it covered too many topics and not enough detail. That's dropped all the way down to 6% for the new framework. For the old AP framework, only 24% of teachers thought it was the right balance. On the new one, that's jumped up to 81%. On the old frameworks, only 62% of teachers thought it was appropriately paced, and on the new framework, 91% do. So I'd like to share with you three myths that are being circulated about the AP US History program that are simply inaccurate, and you heard some of those earlier today. Again, I don't ask you to take my word for this. I ask you to look at the materials yourselves, but I need to go on record in terms of disagreeing with some of the claims you heard earlier today. They're simply inaccurate. So the first claim that you heard is on page 12. The new concept outline removes or reduces the roles of important figures and heroes, the founders, Martin Luther King Jr., the Tuskegee Airmen, etc. The fact of the matter is not a single name has been removed between the old framework and the new framework, because it's not the job of a College Board framework to dictate names to a state. Neither the old framework nor the new framework contain those names, so it's not true that anyone has been cut or removed. In fact, if you look, you can see the quote from the Washington Post, the changes to the AP US History program make it less stressful without being less challenging. It's less stressful because students don't have to cover everything under the sun anymore. It remains challenging because they do have to look closely at historical documents, answer questions about what those documents are saying, and write effective essays. The number of essay questions has increased from 3 to 6 on the new exam. But now teachers and schools have flexibility to focus on the content of most value to them. It's not true that you heard earlier today, you saw a slide earlier today that said that John Winthrop's City on a Hill has been cut. You saw a slide that said that Martin Luther King had been cut. That's not true. Here's what AP teachers are teaching based on the new framework. You are the first group to see these data. In fact, you're the only state that I have visited and presented to. So I'm not sure why it was relevant to make this claim that the College Board is sort of traveling around the country concerned about protecting AP US history. We're a nonprofit, so my motivations are not to protect AP US history. My motivations are to present with accuracy the work that your teachers and professors, with teachers and professors from around the country, did to improve this program. So you can see on page 13, this is what AP teachers are teaching based on the new framework. They start the year by teaching a model of Christian charity, the City on the Hill sermon that Ms. Diddy claims that we cut. You see that they are teaching Thomas Paine's Common Sense. You see that they're teaching the Federalist Papers, the Farewell Address, Declaration of Sentiments from Seneca Falls about women's right to vote, the Gettysburg Address for the first time, wasn't even mentioned in the old framework, Abraham Lincoln's second inaugural address. Move to the right-hand side, you see Booker T. Washington for the first time mentioned there. You see Martin Luther King, I Have a Dream. You heard earlier today from Ms. Diddy that we had cut that. That's simply untrue. This is one of the texts that is taught most often in AP US history because of this new framework. We asked AP teachers, what are the texts that the new framework is giving you time to now teach that you haven't been able to teach in the past? This is what they told us. Malcolm X, Ronald Reagan's address to the National Association of Evangelicals, George Bush's address to the nation on September 11th. These are the top 25 documents that AP US history teachers said the new framework now gives them liberty to teach, when in the past they had to rush through everything that test prep publishers were telling them they had to do. So I understand why these changes are threatening to a test prep publisher. I understand that. These people made their livelihood from selling 429-page books to people because the College Board was only providing 5 pages. If we only provide 5 pages and then we have AP exams that test anything under the sun, parents and teachers feel that they've got to buy test prep. What we've done with the AP redesign is said there's no longer a need to buy test prep because we're going to be transparent with the public for the first time in the AP program's history. We are going to report to the public the results of our survey of colleges and universities nationwide. That survey produces a 50-page concept outline that tells the public, here is what colleges value for college credit and placement. So you can expect that there will be exam questions about these 50 pages. You can expect that because college professors are those who write the AP exam questions. So you can expect that there will be questions, but no longer will we allow them to ask questions about specific details that they may care about, but may not be in your state standards, because every AP exam question now gives the student and the teacher flexibility to cite the example that they chose. So if your state chooses to focus on the Tuskegee Airmen as an example of the concept that in World War II, conditions were favorable for the progression of minority populations in America, you can teach Tuskegee Airmen, and the students can use that as the example for the test question about World War II providing increased opportunities for minorities. But your state might not choose to do that. In New Mexico, your state may choose to focus on the Navajo Code Talkers. And then the students can write about the Navajo Code Talkers and get the same points. That wasn't possible in the old AP US History program. So that's myth number one. Myth number one is somehow that we cut these people. No one's been cut. In fact, teachers are saying they finally have time to actually focus on the founding documents. That's myth number one. Myth number two is that somehow the new framework is downplaying the positive elements and focusing on the negative. I don't understand why Ms. Diddy only shared with you an example from World War II that you might think is negative, the Japanese internment camps, because the framework itself has a full page of information about World War II. It's page 70 of the framework, and we'd be happy to provide you copies of the framework. There is a statement there about the Japanese internment camps. Ms. Diddy's right. But that statement is placed next to statements like, the dominant American role in the Allied victory allowed the United States to emerge from the war as the most powerful nation on earth. I don't know why she chose not to share with you that statement, because that sounds very positive to me. It also says, the United States and its allies achieved victory over the Axis powers because of our military cooperation, our industrial production, our technology advances, our scientific advances, our commitment to advancing democratic ideals. That sounds like a really positive depiction of World War II to me. I don't know why Ms. Diddy didn't want to share that with you. So I do think colleges do have a right to say, we want students to know about the Japanese American internment camps. We want them to know about the dropping of the atomic bomb. But we also want them to know about all of these positive things. And I think it's misleading to only share with you the negative, because the framework attempts to be balanced, to show some things that are unfortunate in our history, like slavery, but also to show some incredibly positive things in our history, like religious tolerance, like the fact that America created the first modern mass democracy. So myth number two is that the framework is somehow negative. That's certainly not the intent. However, I have been concerned that I've been concerned that sometimes when college professors work together, they may miss certain perspectives that are important in a balanced, focused program. And so there's an example of one of these that I would highlight for you that I was concerned about. I first saw this statement 3 years ago in the framework, and it's a statement talking about Ronald Reagan, and it says that among other things that Reagan did during his leadership of the country, he used bellicose rhetoric in his interactions with the Soviet Union. When I first saw that 3 years ago, I have to tell you, it rubbed me a little bit the wrong way. I thought, oh, that feels like a jab. And so I asked the professors who were working on this, I said, why are you using the word bellicose there? And they said, well, Trevor, if you do a Google search for Reagan and rhetoric, what will pop up is Reagan's bellicose rhetoric. It's typically the adjective that is used in college-level textbooks, and we didn't want AP students to be unprepared for that sort of vocabulary word. I said, oh, okay, so I'll defer to that. But it's been a focus of real concern as people have looked at the framework today, and so I've taken that back to the committee of faculty and teachers that work on the framework, and I've said, hey, no matter what your intent was here, that word is being perceived as a jab at Reagan. Was that your intent? They said, absolutely not. We have, our committee is partially conservative, partially liberal. The conservatives on our committee had no intent for that to be a jab at Reagan. So we're happy to change that if that's causing any offense to Reagan's assertive rhetoric or Reagan's rhetoric that threatened military action. They say it is important to understand that Reagan took a forceful approach to the Soviet Union and did threaten military action. That's important because it was a distinguishing feature of his presidency that sets it apart from others. But if that word bellicose is offending anyone, that was not our intent, is what they say. So we're happy to change that. So we've implemented a public review process that runs through February so that anyone who has concerns about any of the statements in the framework, our committee wants to hear those things. What we're not open to doing, is to eliminating statements from the framework that would make it misaligned with college credit requirements or that would tip it towards favoring one political party's values. So we're not willing, for example, as was requested in Colorado, to eliminate examples of civil disobedience. We have no country if there were not a Revolutionary War or a Boston Tea Party. Civil disobedience is part of what makes our country great. All the way up through the Civil Rights Movement and beyond, we need to honor that. And to censor civil disobedience in the Civil Rights Movement from American history means that that would not be a college-level course. So any school that attempts to censor AP US history by removing any of the concepts in the 8 pages of required concepts, we will not allow them to call that course AP. They're welcome to offer their own high school course, but for it to be a college-level AP course, we need that to meet college's requirements, which include the teaching of the Civil Rights Movement and civil disobedience. Let me look at the third and final sort of myth on page 15, and then I'll finish up. The final myth is that the redesign of AP US history is an effort to impose the Common Core. You saw statements about the amount of federal funding that the College Board receives. That information was false. The College Board is a nonprofit organization. Our budget is such that less than 0.5% of our funding comes from the federal government. And what does that federal funding look like? Well, most recently, it was a grant from the National Science Foundation to create AP Computer Science. So that's the sort of grant we get from the federal government, a grant to create AP Computer Science. There has never been the College Board has never received any funding from the federal government for the design of AP US History or the development of the AP US History program. That's not how we work. You heard claims that we receive funding from the Gates Foundation. We have not received any Gates Foundation dollars since 2012. And before that point, it was less, again, than 0.5% of funding the College Board receives. In no way are we obliged to or guided by the federal government in our design of the AP program. We are guided by colleges and universities from your state and 49 other states. We convene your college faculty to work side by side with your AP teachers to design these courses and exams, and then we back them. We support them in raising standards in American schools so that students can qualify for college credit and placement. There was no involvement of the Common Core in the redesign of AP US History. I started this process in 2003. It was done in 2012, before David Coleman became the president of the College Board. I had never heard of the Common Core when we began developing the AP US History program or redesigning the AP US History program. Never once did we look at any documents associated with the Common Core. The Common Core is focused on math and English. This is a history program. There was no involvement in any way of Common Core advocates. We used the same processes we've used for years, bringing college professors and teachers together. The difference is this time we've made their work public by publishing the concepts they say they value for college credit, which is a much slimmer set of requirements than when AP teachers felt like they had to buy test prep to figure out what would be on the AP exam. I want to point out a great irony. This author of Test Prep, who is the person who started these critiques, we released the changes to AP US History over 2 years ago to the public. There was never a concern until this Test Prep author became very upset about things. Conveniently, the year in which his book is no longer viable for sales. So he began calling for a return to the old AP exam. What's ironic, though, is that in his Test Prep books, he says, he himself admits Pearl Harbor is the only World War II battle that has ever appeared on an AP US History exam. Do not expect to see any other battles. So talking about the old exam in the test prep materials he sold, he acknowledges that it was the old AP US History program that didn't talk about battles. In fact, he says never once was there a battle, whereas in the new framework, there are references to battles all throughout the framework. It is an absolute dishonesty to claim that the new framework reduces the role of the military in American history. In his test prep materials, he says, of all the topics to focus on, students spend extra time focusing on oppression and the treatment of Native Americans, women, and minorities because the AP exam focuses on the negative. The new AP framework does require students and teachers to focus on issues of minority, the minority experience, and women's experience and Native American experience. But by Larry Krieger's own admission, that is not a change. This course and exam have not been made more liberal or more leftist in any way. In fact, I have confidence that if you look at the two exams side by side, you would agree that it is the new exam that gives your schools and teachers liberty. And when we piloted this curriculum, before we ever released it to the public 2 years ago, we had teachers try it out to see if we had achieved our goal of giving you more flexibility. And the teachers who piloted it found that they had, on average, 21 more class periods to teach local content than the old framework allowed them. They're saying the new framework is so much more flexible because it doesn't require us to plow through 429 pages of content that we have 21 additional days to focus on doing justice to our local standards. We had people evaluate the framework for fairness and balance between Democratic and Republican perspectives, and we had a 98% approval rate from the public in terms of the balance of the framework. So I know that the test prep industry is upset about these changes, but I see nothing in the new framework or in the new exam that in any way fulfills those complaints that we're hearing. Let me close by telling you the actions we've taken. Because of the misinformation that's been circulated, I've been concerned. I've been concerned about how the public would react, how my own parents would react as they heard about this. In fact, I went home to visit them over Labor Day, and they had taped off of Fox News a description of the redesign of APU's history. And it concerns me that the information they would have about their son's work would say the new AP exam cuts references to George Washington and Benjamin Franklin, when in fact that's not at all true. So I do feel a commitment to making sure the public has the facts so that you can make up your own mind. And so as part of that commitment, we've taken three actions. First of all, we clarified the instructions in the framework to make sure it's clear to the public that the framework is designed to be populated with content from state standards. And we reformatted the framework to make sure that it's very clear to teachers exactly how they have to fill in their own state's content in order to teach any of these historical claims. In addition, we rolled out the public review process that I spoke about. In summary, many people have jumped to the defense of the APUS history redesign. Just this past week, James McPherson, who won the Pulitzer Prize for his treatment of the Civil War, made the statement to the Washington Post, "My sentiments are entirely on the side of the AP history framework. It was put together by teachers and historians who have been working on it for years. It is a sound framework that will help teachers improve the teaching of AP history." I won't go through the following slides, but if you look at them on your own, they're full of statements from all of the nation's leading history associations that undercut the misinformation you've heard and espouse the new history program. The College Board did not request a single one of these statements. These were all generated without any outreach from us. The American Historical Association went on record defending the changes. The Organization of American Historians did the same. The National Council for History Education. All of those attestations, as well as all of our course materials, and the form that anyone in the public can use to recommend revisions to the framework are all available on our website at collegeboard.org/APUSH, because the AP program will always iteratively review and improve our materials based on feedback that is grounded in evidence about the facts of American history. We will not allow the course to espouse one particular point of view on the right or the left, but if there are any improvements that can be made to the framework to ensure that it is aligned with the evidence of American history, you have our commitment to making those changes. Thanks very much.
Okay, questions? Yes, Representative Glenn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Excellent presentation, and Mr. Chairman, whoever did the lineup, I really appreciate that. It kind of brought a lot of clarity to us. My question is pertaining to slide, let me put my glasses on so I'm trying to, I can make sure I can see. On slide 11, you mentioned about the teachers' survey, and you showed the difference, the comparisons in the percentages. Was that the same population of educators that were polled, or just the various on the first and the second survey?
We only counted people here who responded to the before and after. So these represent the same group of teachers looking at the old versus the new.
I do have a question. Obviously, since Common Core was implemented and the exam, the AP exam was 2006, and you had to release something in 2014, with the 44 other states implementing Common Core, you've had to get on your toes and work the stakes, I assume, based on what we've been hearing for the last several years. Is that a fair statement?
We did not consider the Common Core standards in any way in thinking about the new AP US History exam. We see it as a very different issue, that because the Common Core standards are focused on K-12 standards in math and ELA, the standards for AP US History are not high school standards. They're college standards in a specific discipline of US history. So we used a very different process. We used the same process that AP's used for the past 60 years, which is to survey college and university departments, quantify which topics they require for college credit. The difference is we're now releasing those statements to the public, and we haven't released those statements in the past. We think it's good to be transparent with the public about what colleges are requiring for college credit, because we think it puts pressure on everyone to ensure that those requirements are based in evidence.
Okay.
But there was no Common Core involvement.
Okay. Next question. When you solicit, how do you solicit colleges and teachers? How is that done as far as protocol? Is that done through the president or superintendent of the school, or how do y'all do that?
Yep. For colleges and universities, we reach out to the department chair of each department. So in this case, we reached out to the department chairs of the history department, and we asked them to identify for us the faculty person on their campus who was responsible for defining the freshman course requirements, because the AP model is to align with what's required in that freshman course so that students who do that advanced work in high school can skip over it. So that's how we identify the college faculty to review the materials. For the teachers, when a school participates in the AP program, the principal identifies the AP teachers in the school through an annual process called the AP course audit. Once those AP teachers are identified, we have direct contact opportunities with those teachers. So we reach out to all 10,000 AP US History teachers in the country and invite them to provide feedback anytime we do this sort of work.
Do you pay the teachers? Do y'all pay them to participate in any form?
We do not pay the teachers who are surveyed to participate in responding to the survey. When teachers work on weekends with college professors to score the AP exams in June, they receive an honorarium of about $225 per day. And when teachers participate on the curriculum and test development committees, they receive an honorarium of about $800 a day.
Okay. In the state of Georgia, how many colleges actually respond to AP history? I know you show the list of all the colleges, but do you have a number that have responded and number of teachers that you have responded? I know you show a lot of them, but actual response from, say, University of North Georgia, where we are right now.
Right. So by response, do you mean who've responded to our invitations to be involved
kind of
in AP US history?
I'm sure they all don't respond.
The lists I've given you, though, are only from those universities where faculty have responded.
So that is the list.
That is correct.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
Thank you. Yeah. So last night when I was doing my little due diligence getting ready, and I was on the evil internet, looking around, you know, because I've heard the conflicts and debate about this, what we're going to listen to today. I saw Texas. I want you to tell us about Texas. I know their State Board of Education has really put you on hold, asking you to redesign, and also to make sure that Texas standards, the history of Texas, is involved in yours. And would you just kind of address that, what's going on in the Lone Star State?
Sure. So looking back at what the framework looks like, the state of Georgia has done something that hasn't yet been mentioned today that was sponsored by the Georgia Department of Education, and it was work that was done to take this concept outline and to determine, does all of the content that is identified in Georgia state standards, does it fit into these columns where teachers decide what content they're going to teach? So we can provide you with the document that was created by the Georgia Department of Education, or Georgia Department of Education can provide that for you themselves, that shows that your state standards fit really nicely into these overarching concepts that colleges are requiring for college credit. So we have no concerns or no fears that in any way these changes to AP US history will make it harder for AP US history teachers in Georgia to teach your state standards. In fact, it appears that it will make it much more easy for them to do so in the past because we've stripped away the notion that you have to buy test prep and cover 429 pages of content in a really rapid way. So what happened in Texas? Texas has done something very similar. They've made a statement saying, we want all AP US history teachers to cover the Texas standards within the AP US history course. That's completely their prerogative. This is an important issue because, as Ms. Diddy said, frequently the AP US history course in high school substitutes for the high school history course. So if a state has high school standards, it's important that they be addressed if that AP history course is taking the place of a high school history course. You don't see this in other subject areas like calculus. It's not really a conflict because most states don't have calculus high school requirements. It's a college level course. You don't see this in other subject areas where the AP course really clearly sits outside of high school requirements. But in AP history, many students are taking AP US history in place of a high school history course. So it's very fair for a state like Texas to say, look, if we want to send a strong message to our teachers, there's enough sort of rumbling about this new AP framework in our state that we want to make a strong stand and say, my understanding is that the school board, the way Texas law works is that the school board doesn't actually have control over district curricular choices in Texas, but they can express a preference. So my understanding is that the school board's resolution communicates their preference to districts that they use the Texas state standards within the AP US history course. And our perspective is, since the new AP US history course provides teachers with apparently 21 additional periods to cover content that they didn't have time for before, if this was working for the old AP US history exam, it should work even better for this new framework.
But what I read, I believe they voted to ask y'all to redesign so it fits theirs better.
That is not accurate. If you look at there has been a desire by consciously, I think, to persuade other states that a victory was achieved in Texas. There have been misrepresentations of what the school board's resolution was. There was a resolution represented by Ken Mercer, and you might want to look at the Washington Post on this. Washington Post just recently exposed the fact that the chair of their school board, whose term ends this February, rejected the applications from university faculty in her state to be on the History Textbook Review Committee and appointed her own pastor in their place, and that they've approved standards requiring schools to recognize that Moses influenced the founding fathers and things that are simply not historically accurate. Replacing references to the slave trade with the more safe or antiseptic term triangular trade. So there are some political moves that have been made by that school board. There was a resolution that was put forward that was very aggressive about, we want to require the College Board to redesign AP US history. That's simply not something that has come out of those discussions. The resolution affirmed that that schools should use their own standards and encourage the College Board to give due heedance to this public review process, which of course we will, but we won't allow the framework to be censored by those who are espousing one particular political perspective. Our commitment is to college credit for your students, not to whitewashing American history by removing key issues related to minority populations.
Okay, anybody else? Okay, thank you. Thank you for making the trip here. I appreciate it very much. We all do.